are dreams just random images fired from an unconscious brain during sleep? Or something much more important, like life-saving inner guidance? How dreams can be healing and early warning tools for disease, financial crisis, or success? And love is still one of the behavioral science's greatest unanswered questions. Hello, I'm your host, author Kat O'Keefe Kanavos. Welcome to Dreaming Healing, where dreams and cutting-edge scientific research meet on syndicated Dream Vision 7 radio network. Dreaming Healing is every Tuesday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. Eastern, with live shows on the first and third evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific, when you can call in and ask Kat questions about your amazing dreams. Talk on air. Call toll-free 833-220-1200. That's 833-220-1200. Come live your dreams out loud with Kat.
Good evening, everyone. I am so glad you're here. This show is video. So if you're only listening and you want to watch, go to my website, The Queen of Dreams, or Kathleen O'Keefe Kanavos, and that's OKEEFEKANAVOS.com. And in the upper right-hand corner, you'll see this little Dream Vision 7 radio button. Click it. And then you'll go to a page, it'll have a little computer. Click the computer and you get to watch the show. So you may have seen me on my last video podcast about an hour ago, the Kat Kanavos Show live on New Earth TV. And we were talking about coronavirus dreams. And we're going to be touching on that in this show tonight too, because I think it's something that's on everybody's mind. So tonight's show is going to be called Dreams and Intuitive Intelligence. We have Paul O'Brien here, and he is the author of the book Intuitive Intelligence. And oh my goodness, he's so interesting. Wait till you hear some of the things that he's done. And we have Mason Williams, who is the podcaster of All Aboard the Dream Train. And I've got to tell you, his dreams are just amazing. I love his dreams. It's like watching a movie. And he's going to be on sharing some of his dream intelligence with us. So what happens when a vision of creative freedom and creative and courageous risk-taking all happen at the same time? It's called good timing. And what happens when it then comes together with dreams? So author Paul O'Brien and show of All Aboard the Dream Train, Mason Williams, are here to talk about that with us a little bit later, because first, we're gonna start the show off with one of my favorite protection and cleansing meditations. So if you're driving in a car right now, please don't close your eyes. You can listen with your eyes open. It will still work. All right. During this meditation, I want you to imagine using something small but really powerful for you. Maybe it's something given to you in a dream by your guardian angel or spirit guide or a deceased loved one, like an amulet. If you don't have one, just imagine, I don't know, your favorite flower, crystal, or a piece of jewelry in your hand that holds the power of love for you. That is going to be your power gift, all right? Now sit really comfortably, and together, we're going to take these three really deep breaths of life, and we're going to hold them, and we're going to let anything that is not of our highest and best attach itself to that breath of light and life. And then we're going to blow it out across the room, empty all of our lungs, blow it out into the purple flame of Saint Germain, where it will be converted into this beautiful positive light and we return to the universe. We are not going to litter. So then we're going to take our power gift and we're going to build a protection bubble around us. Okay. So if you're driving, again, please don't close your eyes. It will still work. All right, ready? Close your eyes. Feel yourself just relaxing. Just kind of move your head and your neck. You'll hear it cracking. That's good. Take in a deep breath. Now hold it. Imagine any little specks of negativity getting stuck in that breath. Blow it out across the room. Right into the purple flame of Saint Germain. Again, Deep breath in. Imagine any tiny specks connecting to it. Blow it out across the room, right into the purple flame of Saint Germain. Beautiful purple flame. One more time, deep breath in. Imagine any of the little stubborn, kind of looks like pepper, connecting to your breath. Blow it out across the room, all the way out into that purple flame of Saint Germain, where it's poof, converted into this beautiful energy and returned to the universe. Now imagine your power gift in your hand and swing it around your body to create a mirrored bubble of protection that only lets that which is of the highest and best and brought by your spirit guides and guardian angels into that bubble. Anything else that is not of your highest and best is reflected right back from whence it came. We wish it so, and therefore it is. When you're ready, slowly open your eyes. Feels good, doesn't it? So what happens when a vision of creative freedom and creative risk-taking and good timing all come together? What if you focused on what fascinates you and then mastered some skills, including a level of intuitive decision making that helps you make the right moves at the right time in your life? The answer is a dream life filled with success on your own terms. And author Paul O'Brien is here tonight to discuss intuitive intelligence, and he's here with All Aboard the Dream Train podcaster Mason Williams, and together they're going to share insights on how to make a really great decision, a really great intuitive decision. So author Paul O'Brien is a visionary entrepreneur who invented a new category of software in 1989 that evolved to become the world's largest astrology and divination websites. Yep. He sold the company in 2007 and has since authored 3 books. Paul is a sought-after speaker, founder of the Educational Divination Foundation, and we want to know all about his Divination Foundation. We have Mason Williams, who is the host of All Aboard the Dream Train podcast. He focuses on the power of dreams in our waking world, and his dream podcast is Stories and Adventures Created by the Unconscious Brain, retold by the dreamer. And his storytellers take you on a journey describing their nightmares, recurring dreams, lucid dreams, and everything in between, and how their experience has affected them in real life. We're going to combine those two intelligences in the show tonight. Welcome, gentlemen, to the show.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So I brought the two of you together tonight on this show because dreams and divination go together like peanut and butter. My precognitive dreams of those Franciscan monks coming in and telling me I had breast cancer that was missed by the medical community, and the test they relied on 3 times was a dream, but it was a divination dream. And so, Paul, you pretty much tapped into that. And Mason, you've tapped into that with your dream podcast. So I thought, you know, if I wanted to put 2 people together that would really make this an interesting show, I think I just found them. So, Paul, let's start with you. What is intuitive intelligence? And why did you write a book about it?
Well, there's lots of different forms of intelligence, as we know. There's IQ, there's emotional intelligence, there's social intelligence. Esther Perel talks about erotic intelligence. So there's a lot of different forms of intelligence. What occurred to me was that intuition is a form of intelligence in and of itself. And it's actually a kind of a higher form of intelligence than intellectual intelligence in the sense that it can tap into the big picture. it can tap into a much bigger picture and provide us with a sense of direction if we can use it. So cultivating intuitive intelligence was sort of, we all have it, and it was something that played a huge role in my success as an entrepreneur and in my life, in my adult life, in my entire life. And so when I accidentally became an incredible business success, I'm the most accidental entrepreneur ever. People ask me, how did you do that? And I thought, well, you know, I made a lot of crazy decisions that seemed crazy to a lot of people at the time, but seemed completely congruent to me because they were driven by intuition. So I call that visionary decision making. So I sort of like reverse engineered my own story to analyze how did I make decisions. And I realized that the driving skill set was in intuition rather than logic.
Wow. So Mason, do you think our intuitive intelligence that Paul was talking about can be connected and tapped into through our dreams?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just alone, like getting better sleep, paying more attention to your dreams. I mean, it's going to put you, I believe, ahead of most other people. I absolutely believe that.
And do you believe that sometimes in our dreams, I know that you have these fantastic dreams. Do you think maybe there is some messaging to us that is part of our intelligence trying to speak to us in a language we understand in our dreams?
Yeah, definitely. Kind of like how Paul said, there's different types of intelligences, and kind of just being aware of even just being aware of that alone definitely puts you ahead of most people. And kind of just being aware of your dreams, you know, I have my own dreams, but also the people that I interview, it's nice to hear other people's you know, dreams and take on that experience.
Mm-hmm. You know, I really believe that when we remember our dreams, like, you know, you do, Mason, and I haven't even asked you if you remember your dreams, Paul, but I cannot imagine you could be doing the things you're doing without tapping into those divine dream doors, that sacred information that comes through. But I think that when we tap into our dreams and we tap into that intuitive intelligence that's in our dreams, I think it gives us an edge over everybody else who might not have that capability yet, because I believe we're all born with it and then we forget it and we have to learn it again. What are your feelings about that, Paul?
Well, you know, I think it's interesting to compare dreams with the divination process, because as I learned when I developed tarot.com and I Ching.com, that what we're dealing with there is a set of archetypes, and that's what dreams are dealing with, is archetypes. And so then I analyzed, why did tarot.com become so popular? It was a do-it-yourself tarot card reading, but what was the benefit that people were getting out of these tarot card readings? And I analyzed it, and I figured out, well, there's three things: insight, advice, and some sense of which way the wind is blowing, the predictive sense. And I think that dreams offer all of those things too. There's the archetypes in our dreams that can give us insight about ourselves or about situations that we're in life. And sometimes dreams can, you know, actually offer some wisdom if we sit with them and we analyze them. And in your case, the famous dream that you had is a perfect example of a divinatory dream that was basically pointing towards a future development, and gave you, you had all of it in that dream. So I don't know that we always get all three things. And everybody wants, you know, to know what the future is going to bring. That's probably the most popular of the three, but it's probably the more rare of the three. So yeah, there's a lot of correlation between that. And in my dreams, you know, I don't remember a lot of my dreams, but I have been having a lot of very powerful dreams that wake me up in the middle of the night during this coronavirus thing. You know, it's sort of like the coronavirus. It's like living in a dream. It's like living a nightmare. And so, you know, I think that dreams always do us good, even if we aren't able to fully understand what it means or what the symbols mean or what the people in our dreams mean. Maybe we'll figure that out later, especially if we keep a dream journal. Do you keep a dream journal, Kat?
Oh, my goodness. Yes, I do keep a dream journal. I've got a pile this high of dream journals because sometimes I have to go back and I have to actually look at my dreams because I might be looking for information in those dreams. For instance, you were talking about the tarot cards. I actually have a monk who would show up in my dreams if I asked a question or if I set an intention before I went to sleep at night. And he would answer those dreams with a tarot card. By the way, for all of our audience, this is a live show. And so you may see my cats or you may even see my husband walk past. This is, I found it very odd, but I remember one time when I was getting ready to write my book, Dreams That Can Save Your Life. And I asked, you know, how can I do this? Where do I start? How can I get the information that I need? And one of my monks showed up in my dream and flipped the hermit card to me. He never spoke to me. That monk never spoke. He used tarot cards, which I found very interesting because I'm not even sure the Catholic Church sanctions tarot cards.
But they do not.
They do not. So here's this Franciscan monk speaking to me with the hermit tarot card, which if you think about it, the hermit is the person in the dark and he's going with one little lamp in front of him. He's only looking at where he's stepping. He's not paying attention to anything else around him. He's not listening to anybody else. He's not paying attention to anybody else, but he's finding his own way out of the dark. And he's usually in that dark because he dares to think differently from everyone else, which is what I was going through with my monk dreams. Should I keep them a secret? Should I share them with the world? Should I be the monk? Or rather the hermit and just go back into my cave, or should I be the hermit that comes out and starts to make their way out? So, Mason, have you ever had tarot cards in your dreams?
You know, not in my dreams, no. I've played around with them a little bit in real life, but actually in my dreams I haven't. I'm sure they've probably shown up representing some of what the cards are, but not directly, no.
Interesting. I don't know of too many other people who have had tarot cards in their dreams, but I have them quite often. I have them quite often. And sometimes a monk will come and actually give me a spread of three cards. And 9 times out of 10, it's a divination spread and it all comes true.
Wow.
So, you know, it's amazing, Paul. And so, yes, to get back to your question, do I keep a dream journal? I do, because I like to track my dreams. And in order to do that, I've got to go back through my journals. Like, I might have something happen. And I'll go, you know what? I had a dream about that. And I'll go back through my journal and find that, yes, I did. I had a divination dream. It told me that this was going to happen in the dream, and this was going to happen, and this was going to happen. So the first two things happened, and now I'm waiting for the third, and I'll know what to do when it happens. So, yeah, go ahead, Paul.
You know, dreams are a great example of synchronicity in action. And I think it's so great that you are teaching people and modeling for people how to harvest from that source. There is some in my book about using images that come to us in dreams as archetypes that can work as guides. But when I say it's synchronistic, what I mean is it's a coincidence. You know, what's happening is there's an intersection between your subconscious mind and your conscious mind, which is the part of your mind that actually can remember the dream in the morning and then can sort of try to make sense of it. But that's just like a magical event. A synchronicity is where there's a meaningful coincidence. And it's a coincidence that you're having that dream. Now, where it really takes intuition, intuitive intelligence, is figuring out what that dream meant. You know, living into it, feeling into it, and teasing the meaning out of it. And you have to be able to read between the lines to do that. It's a very subtle skill. You can't just analyze it logically. You've got to actually feel into it. And obviously, Kat, you're a tremendous empath and you have this ability to do that. And I think it's fantastic that you're modeling that skill for the rest of us.
No, thank you. Thank you. You know, we're getting ready to go to a break in 1 minute, but there's another podcaster, dream podcaster, Oh, What a Beautiful Morning. And he had this incredible dream that he wanted me to work on with him. And in the dream, he was going through what I call the hallways of his mind. And he went through a door on the left, which is the past. You're right. Usually we talk about these synchronicities and these archetypes of the doors to the right or to the future, the left or to the past. He goes through a door to the left and he's in this huge jungle. And isn't life just one big jungle? And he goes down this path and he suddenly recognizes his dog that he used to have. The dog is passed over. He doesn't tell me that at the time. But he tells me this beautiful golden retriever runs up to him and is so happy to see him. And he starts flying. And the dog is running through the woods with him while he's flying. And all of a sudden the dog gets with another dog. And he doesn't recognize that dog, but it's another golden retriever. So when he told me this dream, I asked, did your golden retriever pass over? Was it dead? And he said, well, yeah, but my dog wasn't really a golden retriever. My dog was a black lab. And I said, well, your dog isn't anymore. It's an angel. It's a spirit guide. And it just hooked up with its brother that died also from its litter. And it wanted you to know that it's very, very happy. And it's so glad to see you. And in the dream, he gets surrounded by these horrible, mean little green monkeys that try to attack him. And the dogs come out of nowhere and they lay down beside him and they growl and they won't let the monkeys at him. Isn't life just full of those nasty little green monkeys? And the actual dream was talking about how our loved ones never die. They never go away. They're always with us, even if it's only in our dreams, to keep us really safe. And those are our archetypes often, the ones we would never believe exist. So don't go away. We're going to be right back. You're listening to Dreaming Healing on DreamVision7Radio.com. And I'm your host, Kathleen O'Keefe Kanavos, aka Kat. The Queen of Dreams is my other name. And you can type that into Google to find my website. We'll be right back.
Ever had a strange dream? Nautilus Award winner, Dreams That Can Save Your Life, Early Warning Signs of Cancer and Other Diseases by Kathleen O'Keefe Kanavos and Duke University radiologist Dr. Larry Burke, forward by Dr. Bernie Siegel, shares how people like you self-advocated in the face of adversity and won using dreams. Read life-saving dream stories validated by medical reports. Hear how dreams of dead loved ones saved lives. Use interpretations and journaling as roadmaps in your waking world for health, wealth, and love. Dreams That Can Save Your Life, Early Warning Signs of Cancer and Other Diseases. Buy the audio and book at KathleenO'KeefeCanavis.com in English and Italian worldwide and through Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and other retailers.
Omega Institute, offering workshops, retreats, and online learning dedicated to awakening the best in the human spirit. For over 40 years, Omega has seen more than 1 million people come through its doors to grow, learn, and find a greater sense of purpose. With over 350 workshops to choose from, Omega offers something for everyone. Located in Rhinebeck, New York, just 90 miles north of New York City, Omega's natural environment and quiet pace allow for extraordinary experiences to unfold. Learn more at eomega.org or call 877-944-2002. Again, 877-944-2002.
What if dreams can diagnose your life? What if we could meet the love of our life in dreams? Join host Kat O'Keefe Kanavos, the number one internationally best-selling author of Dreams That Can Save Your Life, written with Duke University medical doctor Larry Burke. Dreaming Healing is where we'll explore dreams, research, and interpret dreams from you, the caller. Dreaming Healing shows can be heard every Tuesday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. Eastern, with live shows on the first and third evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific Time on syndicated Dream Vision 7 Radio Network. Come live your dreams out loud with Kat.
What if your dog, cat, or horse could help you with your love life? What would they suggest? It's fun to think about and a wonderful way to conduct yourself. After all, animals know well how to love and invite us to love them unconditionally. That's a pretty great way to live life. Animals always communicate with our highest good as their central focus, even when sometimes we feel stymied or frustrated with their behavior. Visit laurarowleyhealer.com to book a workshop or private long-distance phone reading. Laura's readings and workshops help you find the part of you that's able to tune in and connect to your amazing animals. Laura Rowley believes we can all understand by listening differently. Book a workshop or private long-distance phone reading now by going to laurarowleyhealer.com. That's L-A-U-R-A-R-O-W-L-E-Y healer.com.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.
Welcome back to Dreaming Healing on DreamVision7RadioNetwork.com. I'm your host, Kat Kanavos, and we're discussing intuitive intelligence and dreams with guests Paul O'Brien and Mason William. Just before the break, we were talking about dreams and how our dreams are definitely a form of intuitive intelligence, and how a lot of times the symbols and the archetypes that are in our dreams are helping us tap into an intelligence that's available to all of us, but there's only a certain number of us who have figured out how to use it. It's like a secret, and our dreams have the key. So let's talk about that just a little bit more. Mason, do you ever use your dreams as a type of dreams work, where you're tapping into a type of intelligence to help you solve a problem or figure out a solution or work through something?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I haven't been recording dreams for that long, but I think I get a lot of ideas, creative ideas through my dreams. I kind of record everything, even if it doesn't seem like a dream where there would be much to get from that dream. I write it down anyways, because I think maybe at a future time, I can pull something from that possibly. So I kind of record everything, but it seems to be more like creative dreams, but also problem solving as well. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So, Paul, do you see dreams as a possible way to solve some of the problems people might have in their work, in their life, and use them to tap into this intuitive intelligence that you wrote about in your book?
Yes, I do, absolutely. It for me, the value in dreams has to do with the archetypes that come up, whether the archetype be representing a part of the personality, the part of my personality, one of my sub-personalities, perhaps. And a lot of times the people in my dreams, the other people in my dreams, are not really, it's not really about anybody else other than me. It's about different parts of me that are reflected by people that I know, or people that I have known, or people that were influential in my life growing up. And so I'll try to remember that. And you know, when I record my dreams, it's been difficult for me because my my device broke down. I used to use a micro cassette recorder. And I liked that because I could turn it on record in the middle of the night without having needing any light or anything. And it's just going to record at the on the end of the tape rather than having to deal with some digital file and see the bright light in your face and all of that. And then I would transcribe those dreams the next day. And I used to do that religiously for a long time. And it was a really good source of insights for me. But I'm not an expert at dream interpretation like you are. I'm more about, my specialization is more about manifesting dreams. In other words, having a vision, which may be influenced by a dream, or it may be influenced by a divination reading, like an I Ching reading. And in fact, that's what led me to develop I Ching software, was this vision I had that was inspired by the I Ching itself. It's really kind of a interesting recursive story about how I was using the I Ching, and then it occurred to me, I wish I could do this on my computer because I was using it at work. And so then I cast an I Ching reading about whether I should make a software version of the I Ching, and I got the hexagram enthusiasm, which is a very positive archetype, and I could have gotten any number of things like, you know, forget about it, or splitting apart, or any number of things that would have dissuaded me. But so the I Ching sort of, it was a very dreamlike thing. And I had this vision of creating something new, something that was meaningful to me. And that was like a dream. And so what I had studied the laws of manifestation. And so I used a manifestation process that's kind of an extension of the law of attraction in order to create this creative freedom dream that I had, this vision that I had of creative freedom, which was very modest. It was just all about making a living, doing something that I thought was cool. It wasn't about becoming wealthy or, you know, anything else. It was just a very modest dream. Anyway, so my specialization is manifestation, which is sort of like creating dreams that may be inspired by dreams that come to me. The beautiful thing about dreams is that they come to you. It's like meditation, you know, things come to you in meditation sometimes. And sometimes those things are valuable and sometimes they're interfering because, you know, it's just a distraction or just rumination. But so dreams are a very pure form of energy, a very pure form of intelligence coming from the collective unconscious, and it takes intuition to make sense of it, to get the value out of it. So that's where intuitive intelligence comes in. The dreams come to everybody, but it takes intuitive intelligence to read between the lines of a dream or of a divination, of a tarot card reading or an I Ching reading, in order to make sense of it in the context of your own life in the here and now.
Yeah, you explained that so well. You know, I always think of dreams as like living in that fifth and sixth dimension. And then when we wake up, we've got all these little pieces from the dream.
Right.
And I always think of it as pieces of a puzzle, and you pull them down into the third dimension, you start putting them together, and lo and behold, you've got this incredible picture for an answer. And you're going, oh my goodness, I could have never thought that up on my own. I mean, that's just amazing. So
where intuition comes in is intuition is the way that you can put the pieces together, because intuition is a way of having insight into the big picture, where it's the intuition that fills in the dots. Because like you said, it's these scattered bits of information or these fragments of information, and how do you tie those things together? It's sort of like, how did our ancient ancestors figure out the constellations? You know, those were just, they were filling in the dots and they were creating a pattern, and the pattern had an energy, and that was intuition. So that's what intuition is good at, is seeing the big picture, but having to fill in the dots.
Mm. So Mason, are you, you know, when you're doing your podcast, and you're having guests on, are you seeing more guests than usual talking about precognitive dreams or dreams that they feel are messages for them in their waking world?
You know, I get all sorts of dreams. I mean, they're just all across the board. I have had, I had a guest, Dr. Paul Callis, on my show, and he, I'm probably going to butcher this, but he had a precognitive dream about a, like a star cluster, that had never been, discovered before. And it, he had this dream, 9 years prior, and he wrote it down. He drew it. The name that he wrote down was incorrect, but everything else was like spot on. 9 years later, it was discovered. So precognitive dreams. I do have a few of those recorded. But yeah, it's really all kind of across the board.
That's it. You know, what's interesting about the fact that he had that dream 9 years ago, and then he had everything right except the name. I'm not sure he had the name wrong. What if that's what it's called somewhere else?
Absolutely.
The information he got was from somewhere else.
Yeah, it's a really pretty fascinating story.
I love that. Goodness, I would love to interview him. It's sort of like, you know, I remember my grandparents always called me Katrishenka. So if somebody called me Katrishenka and somebody else calls me Kat, is it a different person? No, it's from different people. Mm-hmm. So I really like that dream. Yeah. So let's talk about, there was something that I really wanted to talk about with you. I know what it is. How decision-making is a royal skill. That's what you call it, Paul. You say decision-making is a royal skill. How so? That sounds so interesting. I like royalty.
I mean, basically, decision-making is the highest leverage human activity that there is. Nothing is more accountable for our success and happiness in life than the quality of the choices that we make, the quality of the decisions that we make. And yet, and you'd think that as the only species that can visualize different possible outcomes from different choices we might make, that we would be really good at this by now. But au contraire, we suck. And we're either too emotional and impulsive, or else we're too rational and procrastinating while we wait for more information. Either way, we miss the windows of opportunity. So finding that sweet spot between intuitive leaps and logical considerations, that's the secret of visionary decision-making. And why do I call it the royal skill? Well, after all, it is the thing that we pay CEOs a fortune to do for us. It's what we give politicians immense amount of power to do for us. And then we count on them to make good decisions. And nothing is worse than we have it to have leaders that don't make good decisions or aren't very good at it. And arguably we're in that situation right now. But decision-making is the highest leverage activity. And I like to say that every single person and everybody listening to this podcast is a CEO, is the CEO of their own life. I don't care if they're working for somebody or working for a large corporation, they're actually ultimately, everybody's working for themselves and they make decisions about whether to stay where they are, whether to ask for a raise, whether to work their way up the ladder or whether to go get another job. Now, right now, with unemployment at 25%, freedom is limited. You know, this is a really dark time that we're living through right now. But in general, everybody is responsible for their own success and happiness in life to a great degree, to a much greater degree than they want to, than a lot of people want to accept. And that's why I call decision-making the royal skill. We need to learn how to get really good at this.
Mm-hmm. You also talk about perfect timing. You know, and I believe perfect timing, everything is perfect timing, from getting pregnant to having the right dream at the right time and understanding what it means. You know, perfect timing to me means being in sync with our higher power our spirituality, and our life form. Those three, that trinity that's so important, because we are mind, body, and soul. And I think timing is so important. 2 minutes late, you missed the bus. What are your feelings about timing, Mason? Do you think they're important, especially in dreams? Or do you think the dream world doesn't really rely on timing?
Well, before I go on to timing, back to Paul's question, decision-making, I think it was Colin Powell, don't quote me on that, but he said, sometimes making the wrong decision is better than making no decision at all. So I think you just don't want to be afraid of making the wrong decision, because you can actually learn from that if it is the wrong decision. So better to make a decision rather than none. But as far as timing, I kind of look at that as doing everything possible on the front end to set yourself up for what you want in the future. So if you want your dreams to help you work out a problem, need to be writing those down and kind of focusing on the end goal, I think. Timing is, you can't rush it, you can't hurry it. It's just one of those things you kind of just have to set yourself up for success.
I agree. And you know, with timing also, and with all of this that we've been talking about tonight, to a degree, if we tie it into the tarot cards, again, like sometimes in life, I think my spirit guide, that monk is in my head, and he'll flash a card at me. And right now, as we were talking, the card, the Fool, was flashed at me. Like sometimes we just have to close our eyes and trust in our higher power and trust in all the timing that's going on and step off that cliff. Use that intuitive intelligence to know that there is something bigger than us, and step off that cliff and know that we're going to be all right. We've got our trusty little dog beside us, and we have our little knapsack on our back. And isn't life just one big trip? Anyhow, we've got to go take another break, but when we come back, we're going to share some COVID-19 dreams, because I think everybody's having them. You are listening to Dreaming Healing on Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, and I'm your host, Kathleen O'Keefe Cannabis, aka the Queen of Dreams. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
What if dreams can diagnose your life? What if we can meet the love of our life in dreams? Join host Kat O'Keefe Cannabis, the number one internationally best-selling author of Dreams That Can Save Your Life, written with Duke University medical doctor Larry Burke. Dreaming Healing is where we'll explore dreams, research, and interpret dreams from you, the caller. Dreaming Healing shows can be heard every Tuesday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. Eastern, with live shows on the first and third evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific Time on syndicated Dream Vision 7 Radio Network. Come live your dreams out loud with Kat.
Ever had a strange dream? Nautilus Award winner, Dreams That Can Save Your Life, Early Warning Signs of Cancer and Other Diseases, by Kathleen O'Keefe Cannabis and Duke University radiologist Dr. Larry Burke, forward by Dr. Bernie Siegel, shares how people like you self-advocated in the face of adversity and won using dreams. Read life-saving dream stories validated by medical reports. Hear how dreams of dead loved ones saved lives. Use interpretations and journaling as roadmaps in your waking world for health, wealth, and love. Dreams That Can Save Your Life, Early Warning Signs of Cancer and Other Diseases. Buy the audio and book at KathleenO'KeefeCannabis.com in English and Italian worldwide and through Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and other retailers.
Have you met your physician within yet? The Nautilus and multi-award-winning book, Surviving Cancerland, Intuitive Aspects of Healing, is a memoir that takes you down the rabbit hole of healing dreams and interpretations, mixed with conventional medicine and treatments. Listen to the hookah-puffing caterpillar ask, "Who are you?" Dr. Bernie Siegel says Kathleen's story is powerful, honest, and eye-opening. Surviving Cancerland, Intuitive Aspects of Healing, by three-time breast cancer survivor Kathleen O'Keefe Cannabis. Buy the book and audio at KathleenO'KeefeCannabis.com and worldwide through Amazon and other retailers. Darkest hours to brightest moments. transformation from despair to happiness and chaos to clarity. Real people, real pain, real healing. Life-threatening illness, death, abusive relationships, divorce, and overcoming addiction are challenges these men and women faced head-on. See how they emerged stronger and happier. Buy the new book, Chaos to Clarity, Sacred Stories of Transformational Change by Reverend Patricia Caginello and Kathleen O'Keefe Kanavos. Available on sacredstoriespublishing.com and worldwide through Amazon and other retailers.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network, uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.
Welcome back to Dreaming Healing on DreamVision7.com. I'm your host, author, and video podcaster, Kath Kanavos. Our guests tonight are Paul O'Brien of Intuitive Intelligence and Mason Williams of All Aboard the Dream Train. And we were talking about timing and how dreams can be so important in timing in our life and the information that comes through them and how it all kind of combines into part of our intuitive intelligence if we can tap into that higher power, that higher knowledge. So before we went to break, and before actually the show started, I was talking with my guests about all the COVID-19 dreams people are having, including me. So I decided for the end of the show, we were going to share some of those dreams. But before we do that, I'd really like for Paul to hold up his book because I love the way he has the balance of the rocks. And tell us how we can find your book.
Well, it's for sale in many, many bookstores, and it's certainly for sale on the largest online retailers like Amazon and Barnes and Noble. It's called Intuitive Intelligence, and it's just taking off. I hope people find benefit in it. It's gotten some good reviews, but not enough good reviews. I'd like people to not only get the book, but give it a review.
Let's put a call out to that. You know, get the book, and if you like it, definitely give Paul's book a review because they're so important. We need to get this message out to the world, and that's how you can help. You could be a great help that way.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it would be a big help. I wish I could give it away. I would give it away if I could, but you know, we don't live in that.
The publisher would not be happy at all.
That's right. Exactly.
So, Mason, tell us about your podcast and how we can hear it, where we can hear it, and when.
Yeah, absolutely. So I just started my YouTube channel. So every episode is going to be going to have a video aspect to it now. But I'm on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, any major podcast platform you can find it on, as well as YouTube now. I'm going to be doing live recordings once a week. And I haven't even started that yet. I'm just about to begin that. And I just got done with a move. I moved across the country. And so everything's kind of very out of place right now. So I'm getting back on track with that. Apple Podcasts, you can just Google All Aboard the Dream Train and I'm sure some episodes will pop up.
Yeah, yes. And for all of you listening and watching tonight, you can always go to my Dream Vision 7 Radio Network webpage, Dreaming Healing. And you'll see the links to my guests' websites right there, and they're hot. So you can just click them, and it'll take you right to their websites or wherever their podcasts are, and that is on the page tonight. So just before the break, we were talking about sharing some coronavirus dreams, because I really believe our dreams are a microcosm of our waking world. And we can use our dreams to actually sort through challenges, and our dreams can also tell us what's going on. They can give us information that's not even out yet. And when we get that validation, then we know that we've connected into a higher realm of intelligence. So do you want to start, Paul?
Well, I can start, and I would basically take the position that this coronavirus experience and all that it entails with the quarantining and the physical distancing, it is in itself like a dream. Sometimes I have to pinch myself to make sure I'm not dreaming. And I've had that experience in life. I've had that experience, you know, on psychedelics. I've had that experience many times in my life where I wasn't sure if I was awake or dreaming. And this is kind of one of them. And my vision and my dream coming out of it is that we're going to wake up from this dream and we're going to be better people as a result of lessons that we learned from this dream, including embracing uncertainty, being able to navigate change in the face of extreme uncertainty. And I think it's really the uncertainty of everything right now that is driving everybody crazy. It's very difficult to make long-term decisions based on not knowing, you know, when it's going to be safe to move around. When am I ever going to be able to hug somebody? Stuff like that. It's enough to drive people crazy. But there is a skill set that we can use to realize, well, this is impermanent. Everything is impermanent. This is going to not last forever. This is going to be over. You know, and I think it's kind of ironically a healthy thing to do, to make some plans. You know, it's like if you make some plans for the future, even if it's just a trip, you know, start planning what you're going to do when things loosen up or when they get a treatment or a vaccine or whatever. So I think this is an opportunity to look at this as a kind of a dream state that could represent a spiritual initiation. Now, I don't mean to be glossing over how horrible it can be and how frightening it is and how much anxiety it produces. But what can you do? We have all of this time to deal with the anxiety, unless you're a single mother who's, you know, got to, you know, teach your kids and hold down a job. I mean, this is an opportunity for compassion and gratitude, as well as vision and acceptance of the fact that everything is impermanent and we don't have to know how it's going to end in order to keep faith in our dreams of the future.
Yeah, that's great. I totally agree. What about you, Mason? Have you had any corona dreams?
I mean, yeah, I actually do have. I had one just a few nights ago. Do you want me to go into the actual dream itself? Just kind of walk through. So by day, I'm a truck driver. So I drive 18-wheelers. I've driven all sorts of vehicles. I am pretty good with vehicles. So I'm not going to say I'm the best driver, but I had this dream the other night that I was in a very strange car. I was in a small Miata, a Mazda Miata, and it's not a car I would drive. Nothing wrong with Miata. And it was brown, just the ugliest color. I would never paint my car brown. I'm sure there's some nice brown cars out there. And it was a stick shift, and I was on this incline, and I've driven stick shifts many times. I know how to drive a stick shift. And for the life of me, I could not figure out or get this manual Miata to catch gears and go up this hill. There was a garage door right behind me, and so there was very little room for error. So I'm struggling with this car. I have people driving by looking at me. There's a couple parked in a van that's just kind of staring at me. And I kind of get out of the car and look behind me to make sure everything's okay. And sure enough, I bashed this garage door behind me. Just, it looked pretty mangled. And it's just a situation that otherwise I would never be in. It was just a kind of a helpless, out of my control type of dream. And, I just threw it in my dream journal and we're going to kind of sleep on it from now. But, that was a very, out of place dream for me.
I could see, I was in that dream with you going, you know, oh my gosh, because I bought a little MGB GT. Right out of college, and it was a stick. I've never driven a stick. And I started driving the car, and there were all these big trucks around me. This isn't a dream. This is a nightmare for real. And I realized I could not slow down with that stick shift, and I could only turn right. I drove all the way to my parents' house, which was 45 minutes away, making nothing but right turns. And I had to have my dad drive the car back, and my mom drove me back in their car until I could learn how to work that stick shift. It was horrible. But so I felt your pain just now with that dream. But it's amazing. Our cars are usually our life. And you were in a tiny little life that you didn't fit in anymore. And you were trying to get out of that garage and move up a hill into a new life. And you were still trying to figure out the mechanics of doing that. And isn't it interesting? You just moved across the country into a new home. So, you know, again, our dreams are sometimes a microcosm of our waking world.
There's a lot of very interesting symbolism in that dream. So I just got it down. I'm going to kind of revisit it every once in a while and just kind of see where it goes from there. But it was very out of place for sure.
Yeah. Well, I had one the other night where I was in my dream. I'm always with people in my dream. I'm never alone. I don't think I've ever been in a dream where I've been alone. I've got people, I've got animals. I'm usually in a large group of people at a party, at somebody's house, something. We're always doing something. And I noticed in the dream that there were these two round, kind of fuzzy looking orangish red balls. And they were connected by a tube about this big. They looked a lot like twins, but one ball seemed to be a little bit smaller than the other ball, but they looked to be about the same. They were floating, and they were floating off to my right. And throughout the dreams, no matter what dream doors I went through, they were always there. It's like almost like they were following me, but not following me. They were just a part of my dream. And then when I was doing some research tonight on COVID-19, there was a slide of the COVID virus, and it was two little viri or whatever you call them, connected by a little tube, and they were the orange yellow, and they look kind of fuzzy. And I looked at it immediately and said, oh my gosh, that was in my dream. So there's something about this virus that's more than what it looks like, and we're going to find out more about it in the very near future, but it's not what it seems. That's what I got from that dream. So it'd be interesting to see what other validations I get. Well, believe it or not, guys, we have come to the end of our show. It was so quick. I want to thank you both, Paul and Mason, for being on the show with us tonight. And I want to thank our audience for making Dreaming Healing such a great success. If you have a dream that you'd like to share with us, you know, send it to me in an email. You can go to my website, The Queen of Dreams, and send it to me that way. And if you're a writer who would love to be in the second Sacred Stories of Transformational book series, Crappy to Happy, which is kind of what we're in right now with COVID, in which I collaborated with Sacred Stories Publishing and Dennis Patoko of Biz Catalyst 360 Magazine and Gina Mazza of Creative One Marketing and Advertising and Public Relationships, go to sacredstoriespublishing.com/bookproject up in the upper right hand corner and click on that. Or again, you can go to my website and you'll see in the right upper hand corner it says book projects. Click on that. And I'm happy to announce that James Redfield of Celestine Prophecies is going to be writing the forward. So until next time, remember, everybody dreams, but some dreams save lives. Good night, everybody. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Mason, for being with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us this evening, and a big thanks to our producer. Tune in next time to Dreaming Healing for more cutting-edge research, live dream interpretations, and stories with radio host and award-winning author, Kat O'Keefe Kanavos. Listen every Tuesday at 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. Eastern Time with call-in live shows on the first and third evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific Time on syndicated Dream Vision 7 Radio Network. Remember, everyone dreams, but some dreams save lives. Live your dreams. Find more about Kat at KathleenO'KeefeCannabis.com. That's Kathleen with a K. O-K-E-E-F-E-K-A-N-A-V-O-S. Or the Queen of Dreams on Google search.
This is Dream Vision 7 Radio Network. Uniting mankind with universal love. Our shows are created from the heart, bringing each listener to a place of divine enlightenment. Breathe, relax, and enjoy. Let life flow.